May I come in, sir?
Good morning, sir. Good morning, everyone. Thank you, sir.
How are you, Devanshu? How are you?
I'm good, sir. Thank you.
You're coming from which place now?
Sir, I'm coming from Jaipur.
This morning or came yesterday?
Sir, came yesterday.
You stay in Malviya Nagar?
Yes, sir.
This Malviya Nagar, this personality, who was Malviya?
Sir, it has been named under the name of Shri Madan Mohan Malviya, who was an eminent freedom fighter and personality in the Indian history.
Whether he visited Jaipur or he had made some contribution to Jaipur?
No, sir. There is no contribution as such, but it just has been named because he had an immense contribution in the Indian freedom struggle.
Banswara.
Yes, sir.
Your father belongs to Banswara?
Sir, he comes from Sikar, but I was born in Banswara and lived there for 8 years. Sir, I have lived there for 8 years.
8 years?
Yes, sir.
Till 8 years, till you were 8?
Yes, sir. Yeah?
Tell me something about Banswara.
So, Banswara is the southernmost district, it is the southernmost district of Rajasthan, which also passes through the Tropic of Cancer, and it is famous mostly for bas, because of which the name Banswara has come. The bamboo growth is really fast there. At the same time, it is also famous for Tripura Sundari, which is one of the Shakti Pithas in India, and Mahi Dam and the Mahi River, because of which greater agricultural and forest tribal products are being grown in this area.
Tell me something about your school. What is this stand? Anselm's PC School.
Sir, St. Anselm's was a 3rd century Italian saint who was responsible for spreading Christianity in the Europe and across the world. And the Christianity that was brought to India under its name was in the French time, in the 1664 year, when the French East India Company was established.
Do you believe in God?
Yes, sir, I do.
So you read a lot of Indian mythology?
Yes, sir, particularly the Mahabharata.
I have a confusion. In Hindus, there are so many gods. Shri Ram, Shri Krishna, Shivji, Mahesh, Brahma. Whom should we worship? Eh? If I worship one, I am fearing that other god will get angry with me. Eh? If I worship second, third will get angry. So, how I should worship? I am having a lot of confusion.
Sir, the Hindu religion is a way of life, and worshipping one god doesn't necessarily mean that we will be disobeying the command of the other gods. And I believe that worshipping one god and keeping a faith in any religion represents our inside soul, and at the same time, what exactly do we plan to do in future because of that faith. So I do not think that worshipping any god will disobey the other god.
But see, in Mahabharata, Krishna says, I am everything. I am most powerful. But what I hear from others, they say only this Shivji is the most powerful god. So I fear that if I worship Krishna or Ram, Shivji will get angry with me. And there are different things to be done. For Shivji, you do different type of puja. For Krishna, you do different type of puja. Can you find a solution for me?
So the only solution that I can think of is that we should place our faith in God and not
which
in his
God?
Many forms.
Which God? That is my confusion. Which God? All these are not gods. Which God?
So in my opinion, God is an omnipotent entity who is a soul person and in which he or she should
Achha, play. Okay. Tell me this Olympics you have read.
Yes, sir.
We have won something. Achieved which I have never achieved before.
Yes, sir.
And there must have been many Olympics in which our tally was zero.
Yes, sir.
Recent past?
Yes, sir. We had won 7 medals in this Olympics, and in the Rio Olympics we had 2 medals.
And before that, any medal, any Olympic you remember where we have not won even a single medal?
Sir, before 2000, there were some Olympics games in which we did not win any single medal.
Achha. this time this track records have been tumbled. Newspaper says that track laying was very technical this time. Have you read that? Laying of turf.
I am sorry, sir. I have not read about it.
You have not read?
Yes, sir.
Because they say you get automatically, you get some push.
So thank you for the information.
Okay. Artifacts. You know, we have a lot of artifacts of our mythology, culture and all, stolen by others and lying in different museums throughout the world.
Yes, sir.
Some we are getting back. You have read somewhere?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Now, recently something came that Australia is sending us back some artifacts. Why they are sending back?
Sir, the one reason I believe is that because in India, the religion represents a way of culture, and the relations between two countries is also based on soft power of these two nations. So they believe that better relations can be inculcated between these two countries by sending back these idols.
But Kohinoor, we are not getting back. They don't want good relations with us.
So that is a subjective opinion, but I do not have any clarity regarding that.
Yeah.
So, social marketing refers to the marketing activities that are being taken place across various interfaces for various categories of people, which are derived by segmentation, targeting and positioning of these people.
What is the difference between social marketing and the corporate marketing?
So, corporate marketing is primarily taking place to have a good brand value and at the same time equity in terms of consumer satisfaction and perception, while social marketing majorly refers to having a good responsibility for all the stakeholders that are present for a corporate in the actual environment.
When we say social marketing, there is a striking difference should come out in the explanation. Anyway, that is not coming out.
Tell me the marketing.
What do you mean by marketing?
Can you define marketing?
Sir, marketing can be defined as the activities that are primarily dependent on the 4P, product, price, place and promotion of various products and services that a company needs to launch.
Binjor in Rajasthan was in the news today. Can you say why it was in the news?
I am sorry, sir. I have not read about it.
What is the difference between e-rupee and cryptocurrency?
So, e-rupee is a digital payment system where SMS or QR code based vouchers can be sent via phones to the beneficiaries so that they can avail the necessarily social security
services. Paytm also uses QR code. What is the difference between Paytm and e-rupee?
Sir, in Paytm, we need a bank account for conducting the transactions, while in e-rupee, we do not need a bank account. A phone number is sufficient for sending an SMS or QR-based code, and it can be then used at the particular POS for availing the services.
Okay. Layman like us.
So, Bayes' theorem is a theorem based on probability distribution where various incidents that can take place are derived on the conditional probability of having one incident based on the other, and then the overall probability is then calculated based on that. So conditional probability along with the chances of occurrence of one particular event are multiplied together, and then the average is taken out to calculate the Bayes theorem.
Are you sure about your explanation?
Yes, sir.
An example, with the example you can explain this.
So the example can be Monty Hall problem, where if in a game show, there is one door behind which a goat is there, two doors behind which a goat is there, and one there is a car, and one door is revealed saying that this is a goat. So now it would be the best interest of the participant to change to the other door as compared to his first option, because the probability by Bayes theorem has now increased to 66% rather than 33% in the first case.
Bayes theorem.
So must be given by Bayes, but I am not
Who
sure
is
about
Bayes?
Him. I have not read about him, sir.
What is the history behind the
Bayes theorem? Are you aware of that?
No, sir. I am not aware of it.
Okay. What are the conditions or factors which led to beginning of movement, and what happened to Mahatma Gandhi after the launch of beginning of movement?
So the Quit India movement was launched in the precinct of the Second World War in the on the date of August 8, 1942. And the conditions were that the British were eagerly waiting for the Indian to participate in the war so that they can tackle the Japanese invasion. But at the same time, Mahatma Gandhi said that there will be no support for the British if they do not promise complete independence, which was not given by Simon Cripps report and other commissions as well. So this was the reason, and Mahatma Gandhi was immediately arrested after starting the Quit India movement in the Govalia tank of Bombay, and hence there were also very much disadvantages as to breaking down of rampage and underground activities.
Where was he incarcerated after arrest?
I am sorry, sir, I do not recall that.
Okay,
the history we read. There is also some other narration telling one more ulterior motive was there to launch Quit India movement by Mahatma Gandhi. Can you think of what would be the motive? You can guess.
So at that time, the communal situation in India was also at a very bad situation. So the Quit India movement was also launched to have Hindu-Muslim unity, based on which we can have an united India in the future. But that did not take place, unfortunately.
Last question. Just to trace the history of NSS in India.
So NSS was established on the date 24th September 1969 at the Rajghat, which was the 100th birth anniversary of Mahatma Gandhi. And Mr. K.K. Gupta from Delhi University was the first NSS volunteer. Since then, it has grown multifolds, and now NSS branches are very much prevalent in various universities, college. At the same time, there's also a structure from the university to the national level.
Mr. Chaudhary, you said you have interest in Mahabharata.
Yes, sir.
Tell me, what are the five lessons from Mahabharata? If I say just five.
Sir, we can learn multiple lessons from the Mahabharata. The first is that revengeful instinct and greed can lead to one's downfall, which we see particularly in the case of Kauravas and Duryodhan. The second is woman empowerment, particularly in the case of Pandavas, was very much necessary. And a motivation for destroying Kauravas was also the thing that happened to Draupadi in the Kauravas court. So they gave more attention to their women as well. The third one was that if we see about Karna, who is my favorite character, then the zeal of social service was present inside him, and he was also very much interested in donating things to Brahmins who came to him. And also at the same time, we say that the Mahabharata was a lesson in which the good always triumphs over the bad if the God sides with the good. God sides with the good and rational decisions are made.
You have missed the most important points.
So can you please enlighten me on which one?
There is one lesson from Mahabharata. It's about friendship.
I am sorry, sir.
It's about friendship. If you have a friend, you should have only two categories of kinds of friends. One is about like Krishna. If he is with you, you will never lose.
Yes, sir.
Or like Karna, which is your favorite character.
Yes, sir.
He will be with you even if he knows for sure that you are going to lose. But he will never leave.
Yes, sir.
People say, those who have read Mahabharata, they say you should have friends like either Krishna or Karna.
Or Karna. Yes, sir. Thank you for the information.
Other such examples. But that's a different thing. Tell me, UP government has some new population policy.
Sir, can you please repeat UP that?
UP government has released a population policy. Do you think we need that kind of policy in India at this time? Specifically, do we need that?
So the UP population policy is a good initiative in terms of the incentives and the awareness programs that it caters to, but it is not good with respect to the two-child norm that the policy caters to. This is because of three reasons. First, with the falling total fertility rate, we do not really require a population policy as India is about to reach the replacement fertility rate of 2.1. The second is that if we have a population policy like such, there will be a violation of Article 21 catering to reproductive freedom rights of women, and we can see a decline in gender sex ratio and abortions that can take place at a rapid pace. And thirdly, if we go for such a policy, we will be following China, which now is coming on with a three-child policy, and that will destabilize our population and cater to a negative demographic dividend. So I do not think it is necessary.
What is UP's TFR?
I'm sorry, sir?
What is TFR of UP?
Sir, as per the NFHS 2015-16, it is closely around 2.7, but it is coming down.
Should we abolish celibacy?
Sir, sedition law, which is catering to IPC Section 124.
First, should we abolish it? Yes or no, and then you can give your arguments.
Sir, we should not abolish sedition. The primary thing is that the sedition law is being misused by the government, as also being said by the Supreme Court, and hence we need to tackle the misuse rather than giving away with the law, because national integrity and protecting the sovereignty of India is also of prime importance.
We have lots of laws. We have UAPA, we have NSA, we have NAPOCA, lots of laws to deal with. Why are you retain this?
So the sedition law primarily caters to the disaffection against government, and it is much needed for these values. But going forward in the future, we can go for sensitization of police and awareness generation so that the misuse can be curbed rather than going away with the law.
My final question, have you watched the film The Man Who Knew Infinity?
Yes, sir, I have.
Who is the lead character?
So Srinivas Ramanujan, played by Dev Patel, is the lead character.
And who wrote that book?
Sir, it is written by Robert Campbell. Thank you, sir.
The population policy. But let's say that a population policy will help us reach the goal faster of the replacement level. Let's say that if you go by the current pace, it will probably take 2 decades to reach the replacement level. And with a policy, we probably reach it 1 decade. So don't you think a population policy would be more useful than not having a population policy?
So, as you rightly mentioned, we can reach the goal faster, but there are two things that go against it. Firstly, we will be having a bigger impact on our demographic dividend, which right now stands at around 2041 for India, and that should be the one that we should be harnessing rather than going for the population policy. And secondly, since it also alters the Article 21 and the gender sex ratio, I think giving the fundamental rights is primarily necessary, and the population can be reached at a later stage also. So these two reasons are the prime reasons we should not go for a population policy.
Citibank is exiting from India.
Yes.
What is the reason? Why are they exiting from the big market, the emerging market?
So they are exiting primarily in the consumer banking segment, where the market share of foreign banks is very low as compared to the Indian banks, and hence they do not find it profitable to work in that segment.
Indian banks have not reached global sector like HSBC. HSBC is a China-based bank. But you don't see SBI or Canara Bank spreading its wings across the globe. Why have we not been able to do that?
So the primary reasons are because there are certain conditions because of which the Indian banks are lagging behind. First is the issue of NPAs. That is arising because of lack of due diligence, technological innovations, and regulation autonomy is missing in the Indian banks. And also there are various conditions that restrict the Indian markets primarily to our society because of priority sector lending and other such stuff, so that the major part of their capital is rolled out in the Indian market and they are not left with much capital for the foreign market. So these are the major reasons because of which they are not able to spread out.
What was their role as a business management analyst?
Sir, I was responsible, my team was responsible for launching UPI 2.0, and my role primarily catered to analyzing the value and volume flows of UPI to our global customers, and at the same time what are the technical issues that cater to UPI 2.0.
So how do you compare global presence of UPI versus India's scenario?
Sir, the Indian scenario of UPI is a very good example of how rapidly the UPI is picking up. For example, in India, 25 trillion rupees is the digital payments market, where 8 trillion rupees comes from UPI. So I think it's a major chunk of digital payments, and we will soon be able to catch up with the global UPI market as well.
How is the statistics globally? Is
India? Any idea? Sir, the exact numbers I'm not aware of, sorry.
Mobile banking, M-Pesa, African markets, they have done extremely well compared to India.
Yes, sir.
Any idea why, there are similar demographic scenarios between African nations like Nigeria and India? But despite of that, mobile banking has not done as well in India as compared to Nigeria.
So the issues can be firstly internet penetration, which may have taken place more in Nigeria as compared to India, because of which mobile banking is present at a wide scale. Also, the mistrust of digital payments, particularly in the Indian market, where the perception of data theft and security issues is very large. So I think if that can be catered to well, we can also do very well in the mobile segment.
MasterCard was in news recently.
Yes, sir.
What was it about?
So the RBI has issued a directive to MasterCards to stop producing its debit and credit cards in the near future.
So is there any parallels between Indian mythology and Western mythology? Let's say Indian mythology versus Greek mythology.
I am really sorry, sir, but I have not read the Greek mythology actually.
300 Ramayanas. There was a controversy. You're familiar with this?
No, sir. I'm sorry. I'm not aware of it.
Reading biographies, what do you read? What was the last three books that you've read?
So the last book was actually The Man Who Knew Infinity by Robert Hanegel. And apart from that, I also read biographies of Mahatma Gandhi, My Experiments with Truth, and Abhinav Bindra and Milkha Singh as well.
Abhinav Bindra's biography, I think that has more relevance now.
Yes, sir.
Can you tell me what you learned by reading that biography?
So there were two primary lessons that I learned. First was that Abhinav Bindra talked about detachment from result and focusing on the process, because he had lost the medal in Athens Olympics because of a loose tile on which he fired the range. So that was the first learning. And the second was to fight hard and work hard because of which the result can be then produced in our favor. So getting up from the lowest point and getting our chips back is the biggest learning from Abhinav Bindra's biography.
Last question. You seem to be a very well-educated and well-experienced person. What's your biggest weakness?
So my biggest weakness is food habits. I'm a very big foodie and I cannot control my urges when it comes to food. So I am gaining a sort of weight, particularly in this time. So that's my biggest weakness.
Okay. Did you answer your interviews over?